aesthetics.
Absolutely.
Now's the time to get them. Last time we had the video store, they were.
Yeah, good point.
And they mentioned that in the submission requirements, they don't get in a lot of detail, though, so you may want to press a little more.
It was almost as if they were talking about one particular area across the, from the sites just changing the
scale. Yeah, they talked about kind of making uniforms and standards down the road. Something
as long as they change the sign out on the road.
You may want to bring it up. The missing letters. just so you know, those for Pondco, there's a checklist that was sent with it. There was, it's supposed to be 2 pages. The last 2 pages of that checklist was from the word processor. Has all sorts of scrawl. Disregard that. That was an error.
Oh, that last page?
That last two pages.
And then we have Highlands of Broad Cove coming in for a pre-application conference. Something that we want to explore with them as to what their plans are, and, because it is in the pre-application form. Elizabeth Farms is still coming before us for an amended food plan. They do not have Central Maine Power or DEP approval yet to change the road, so we need to make sure that we ask for that.
I got a letter in my mail this afternoon that talks about the CMP situation. They haven't resolved it, but they're close. I have to check with Jane to see if you have got a copy of that. If not, I'll ask if the copy's run off. I have a feeling you didn't.
What's this? You lost?
You just got it? Okay. Let's
find that out during the break. Because we were and Galpas Farms will be coming in for major subdivision preliminary plan approval, and that is something that we have not seen too much of yet, so there will be a lot of questions we want to ask about the land that will be donated and what amount of clustering they do intend to do and where that clustering is going to take place. Anything else before we get started? I'd like to call the meeting of the board to order. And for the record, we have everyone present with the exception of Bill Russ and Ivan Most.
Just walk in.
Excuse me, we have a walking distance girl, Russ, arriving. And so we have everyone present with the exception of Mr. Ivan Most. I would like to appoint Mr. Joel Russ as a voting member tonight. And I also would like to welcome Mr. Gregory Cross to the Planning Board as a new associate member, and we're very happy and pleased to have you with us. We have two sets of minutes to approve. A planning board set of minutes dated March 15th, 1988. You all received a copy of that. Is there a motion to approve? Second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is unanimous. And we have a workshop set of minutes dated April
3rd. Those are really not necessarily planning board. They were just going to be your information.
Okay. Do you have some?
These are the 22nd. The ones that have to be approved.
Do I have a copy?
Mm-hmm.
Do they all have? There are also some planning board minutes from March 22nd, which I would entertain a motion for acceptance.
Madam Chairman, before we accept them, I just think that the record should be straight. On page 2, it says, Mrs. Guthrie asked, this had to do with the Pondco Shopping Center.
Mm-hmm.
What they have planned for the signage. It wasn't only the signage. I had a concern about the aesthetics. they had proposed some aluminum doors for these two new stores, and I think I brought out at that time that the hodgepodge didn't have to do with the signage. It had to do with the aesthetics.
Do you want to suggest aesthetics. Are there any other corrections or amendments to the minutes of the 22nd?
Will they be accepted as amended?
Is there any second? I hope.
Second.
We have a large second. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Motion is unanimous. A little correspondence has been received. You have in front of you a letter dated April 15th from Peggy McGehee in regard to the F.S. Comer application addressed to the planning board. And you also have a letter dated 4/18 from Clifton and Barbara Curtis, which has to do with the Runaway Farms application. Is there any other correspondence to come before us? If not, I would just note for our viewers and our large audience that we are in a new policy in which we will start our planning board meetings from now on at 7 o'clock and try to wrap up in a civil hour by having our last item on the agenda scheduled for 10 o'clock so that we're not into the twilight hours. We also have agreed to another policy which I would like to see if we could keep to, and that is to have presentations by applicants to be no longer than 15 minutes in time. We hope that all the material which they would like to present could be done within the scope of that time frame. Under old business, our first item on the agenda is Runaway Farms, and we have a public hearing. I would like to remind the public that it is important for you to come forward and state your name and your address and speak clearly into the microphone for the record. I will now open the public hearing, and we'll have a presentation by a representative of the developer.
Thank you. My name is Stephen Moore. I'm a landscape architect with Land Use Consultants. I am here on behalf of the applicant for Runaway Farms, Lawrence Eubank. Unfortunately, Lawrence is caught in an airport in Washington, D.C. His father had a surgery earlier in the week, and Lawrence had to fly unexpectedly down there, so he could not be here this evening. So to the extent that I can, I'll answer any questions that the board might have on matters concerning general areas of Lawrence Eubank's responsibility. If I can, for the benefit of the board and the public, just run through the basic proposal that's before you. The site in question is one that is bounded by Bowery Beach Road, Spurwink Avenue, and Fowler Road, and it consists of approximately 28 acres. The 28 acres are roughly rectangular in shape, having 660 feet of frontage on Bowery Beach Road, and extending back into the site approximately 1,800 feet. And it's shown on this plan here, which is the overall subdivision plan. That in dark green is the area of field and existing gravel pit up front. The area in the back is the existing cedar swamp and a low-lying area which eventually feeds out and into Pollock Brook. The existing site is primarily outwash sands in the front portion. There's an old inactive gravel pit located in the extreme northern corner that occupies approximately an acre and a half to 2 acres. The balance of the site to the rear is primarily wooded with cedar and red maple. What is proposed by the applicant is to develop a total of 5 lots. Four of those lots will be for residential use. Those four lots range in size from slightly over 2 acres up to approximately 140,000 square feet. Those four residential lots are taken on the front portion of the parcel where the soils and existing vegetation and drainage are appropriate for that type of use. On the rear portion, lot 5, that is a parcel of approximately 19 acres which is proposed to be conveyed to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. That conveyance also includes a 10-foot wide strip which runs out to Spurwink Avenue and is intended to provide pedestrian access on a permanent basis, on a fee interest basis, into that lot 5. The balance of the site will remain in that undeveloped state, that is the 19 acres will remain as a conservation area, and the front portion of the site will be developed into the lots. Excuse me for a minute while I turn my back. The proposal on the four lots is to create a series of house lots which take their frontage from Bowery Beach Road and the Fowler Road. This 40-scale site plan is an enlargement of the subdivision plan and indicates the lot layout that would occur on the front portion of the parcel. What's shown in the dark brown are the proposed building locations for the lots. In all cases, the buildings have been sited to try and take advantage of existing vegetation for buffering and to locate the building where they will maintain some visual access and integrity in the existing field and yet not encumber any of the budding properties. Each of the lots will be served by an on-site subsurface disposal system, and the supporting HHE 200s have been included in your package. There will be underground electrical service into each lot, 3 from Bowery Beach Road and 1 underground service in from Fowler. Again, in your package, CMP has indicated ability to service all 4 of those lots. The last utility item is one of water. We are proposing to have individual water leads into each of the lots, and the Portland Water District has indicated adequate service from Bowery Beach Road for each of these 3 lots, and then lot 4 again from Spurwink, pulling in an underground water line into that parcel. The plan does have designated building windows, which are somewhat smaller than those normally required or set forth in the zoning ordinance. Those building windows were reduced and laid out and are shown on the recording plat specifically so that Mr. Eubank could regulate the locations of the homes within the lots and not have a further discretion by some of the lot owners for placements of the homes within those lots. In addition, each of those house lots has a designated driveway location. The reason that was done was threefold. Again, to allow Mr. Eubank to have some control over placement and layout of the driveways and the buildings. Mr. Eubank is proposing to build each of these houses, 4 potential buyers, so Mr. Eubank will be following through with all 4. Included in your submission was a site distance calculation for each of those driveways, and in all cases for all 4 driveways, the site distance study indicated there was adequate site distance both east and west and north and south, as it were on Spurwink, for the site distances for those lots. With regard to storm drainage, as I mentioned earlier, the existing lot does have approximately 1.5 to 2 acres of existing disturbed gravel pit. The majority of the site that's proposed to be developed is an open field that is grassed. This area in here includes an expended gravel pit, which is the low area right in here, and then disturbed areas with exposed ledge. As a part of his proposal, Mr. Eubank is looking to revegetate, loam and seed that disturbed area and roll the banks in and eliminate that low spot. Right now, the storm drainage runs down in to an extended pit, which is shown on the plan, and that traps the water down in there. As far as we've been able to tell from on-site investigation, there's no positive outflow from that other than in storm conditions when that builds up and then runs out. So part of the proposal is to grade that out and get that pocket out to get the storm drainage to flow down into the rear of the site. The hydrologic study that was done had indicated that the pre- and post-development flows actually lowered a bit because of the loaming and seeding, so that we don't foresee or indicate any negative impact from the storm drainage exiting the site at the point down into the marsh here where the development ends. I think that, in a summary fashion, in less than 15 minutes is the site plan that's before you. What Mr. Eubank was seeking this evening was public input and comment from the board and hopefully a final approval. Obviously, we still have some additional items to look at as far as council reviewing this space dedication and the easement, but our hope was that we could move through those in a conditional approval and allow him to bring those forward to council. It's somewhat of a chicken and an egg situation with the easement and the council because the applicant is looking for some form of approval prior to dedicating that land formally to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and then allowing the council to accept that. So with that as my closing comment, I would turn it back to the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any members of the public that would like to comment on the proposal? If not, I will close the public hearing and open the matter up for questions from the board. And I would remind the board that there are still some outstanding issues in regard to this application, one of which is giving waivers to the development. There are two, as Mr. Butler, our planner, mentioned, two areas where we would need to grant waivers, one in which on page 1940, the first 50 feet usually required to be paved, and also usually there is a requirement that there be at least a 22-foot minimum pavement. Other issues I think that are still outstanding is the desire to indicate somehow a boundary between the pedestrian easement or access going into the property and the driveway that exists, perhaps considering a buffer of some sort there. I would ask the board if they have some questions at this point of the
Could you point out where the talk about the windows for the houses, where those are
on? On the 40 scale plan? Looking at each of the lots, and looking at what is shown here as lot 3, the building window is restricting development to the front portion of the site, and it's shown as these dashed lines set in from the property line. What's been done here is that the sideline setback from the interior line to lot 2 has been expanded out to 50 feet. The rear line setback has been pulled to 30, as has the side yard, and then the front yard has been maintained at 50 feet, so that the building, as it's shown in here, has some limited ability to slide forward and side to side that cannot be developed back in here. And the purpose of that is really threefold. The first is these oak trees, which most of you probably know as driving by the site, are a very important amenity, we feel, to the site as a whole and to the public on Barry Beach. And by pulling that window back, we're restricting development in and around the crowns of those trees. And as part of the driveway construction, we proposed some specific mitigation measures when working in and around those trees there to site that driveway in and through. We picked the largest opening in there to pull that driveway in. Secondarily, the feeling was that by expanding the setbacks from the sides, we would maintain a buffer between the existing neighbors and this house, proposed house location, and as well protect that existing field so that you don't end up with a house sitting out near the edge of that field. As you drive by and look, what you see primarily as a view corridor is the field in here. The last item for the reason of that restricted building window is to prevent a building from being erected back in here. Again, for that same reason of wanting to protect that rear portion of the field. On lot 2, there's an existing vegetative line that sits along about the midpoint or center section of the site. The building window here, again, is intended to keep the building restricted to the center and towards that vegetation, but allow that a little more freedom front to rear because of the extent of vegetative buffer. So that restricted building setback on lot two sits at the top of bank here, so it doesn't encroach into the gravel pit.
What would be the maximum distance towards lot one that a house could be built on lot two? If you just, with your pen, show the outer line.
The closest that a house on lot two could be built would be right there.
So that would, does that include the setback, or is that the lot line?
That is the setback line that I'm pointing to here, which is 30 feet from the property line. So the closest that that house could be to the other house would be 80 feet, but it would be a maximum of 30 feet off that line.
If you got it out about what you're showing, then one of the, I think, values of the concept that you've proposed could be threatened a little bit, and that is if somebody's driving along Bowery Beach, the view down that very scenic field could be lost if somebody decided to move that house out where you're pointing, I think. As a matter of fact, I drove by there the other day, and it looks like the angle that you, when you pass those oak trees, the angle would, if you move that out much farther than you have it now, the angle would really hit you. But what's the need to have it any farther out than it is now from the stand of trees?
The intent in here is that this begins to slope off towards the gravel pit, and dependent upon the type of house, there may be a need to get that up onto a little flatter portion of the site. In looking at this from a view corridor standpoint, our feeling was that we had set that such that we wouldn't block what we felt was that view here and then the view through the oaks into this back portion. I think sliding that out would have some effect of losing this back corner for view, but it wouldn't impinge on this view here from through the trees at that point.
Remind me again, how are you going to assure that that these lot windows are enforced?
The proposal is really a two-step method. The first one was to put them on the recording plat, which they are, and label them as building windows. And the second, and probably the very real way that that would be enforced, is Mr. Eubank will be building these homes himself. He felt that by putting those on the recording plat, that gave him, or his request for placing those homes, some legitimacy, were one of his proposed buyers to come forward and say, I want to move the house out into the field. He has some protection in those building windows and some legitimacy, other than his word simply saying, that's where the house has to be built. So that really was the intent, that first the recording plat show those, and then second that Mr. Eubank, because he is building them, would follow through on that. On lot three, the building window is tightened up to sit really up in what is probably the one area of the site which is immediately buildable in terms of existing grade and soil. The building window on lot three is restricted to this corner. And again, that's done to keep it out of the swale and the vegetation and maintain that buffer, and then to keep it out of the lower portion of the site, which really becomes a drainage way through, so that the building window reflects really what Mr. Eubank had indicated as a building setting. It's his feeling that that would be probably the first structure to be built.
You don't have to bother with four. I think four is self-explanatory.
Are there other questions? Mrs. Guthrie?
Madam Chairman, concerning the 12-foot right-of-way from lot 4 to Spurwink, on January 15th, you submitted a packet to us, and on page 2, you said that that would be paved up to the house. And now do I understand that you're proposing gravel, the 12-foot?
No, that is indicated on the plans as being a paved road.
Yeah.
And the intent is to pave that from Spurwink Avenue into the house site at a 10-foot width, so that the waiver that would be requested would be, I think, primarily to narrow that width down from 22 to 10. And the reasons that were discussed at that time were to preclude people from parking in that entrance area. And that's a 40-foot right-of-way into Lot 4. As another footnote to my presentation, because I did run through it, we would be requesting a public access waiver for Lot 4 for the reasons that were enumerated in the presentation.
Thank you.
Yes,
just a quick question for clarification's sake. Plan showed 12 feet in width. Is it, you want 10 or 12? My version of the plan say 12.
Your versions of the plan are correct.
Okay.
I stand correct. It should be 12 feet.
Madam Chairman, as you're aware, the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust has negotiated with the owners of the property to secure a 19-acre parcel for conservation purposes and as part of the plan. And as a member of the Board of Directors of the Land Trust, I feel it may be inappropriate to vote on the matter and would ask the Chair's permission to abstain from discussion and voting on the matter.
Granted.
Thank you.
Mrs. Guthrie. Madam Chairman, since that was brought up, Mr. Eubanks' project usually came up very late. I don't know why he was on always very late, and we were very tired, but I would just like you to convey to him and to Mr. Drynan, I think, how great getting this 19 acres is. And personally, I can't speak for the rest of the board. I'm very impressed with the conveyance to the Land Trust, and I wish that more people did it.
Thank you.
You indicated that the old gravel pit is the location where the drainage presently goes, and that when you fill in the gravel pit to accommodate the house, that that is going to go someplace else. Would you just explain on that plan what plan is?
Right now, the existing site drainage works in this fashion, to back up and walk you through that. Barrier Beach Road runs down to a low point approximately in here, and then the road drainage from this side over runs down. These upper houses here actually drain down into this property, as does Mr. Layton's property here, so that right now the existing site sits pretty much in a bowl. There's a swale here which picks up the drainage from these houses and carries it down into another expended gravel pit, and then by overland flow down into the back portion of the site. This section of the site catches road drainage in the swale, and it runs down and sits in this low pit. At about 3 feet in elevation, that pit tops out and then runs in a swale, following the end of my finger, down here into another pit and then out again. So it's a system of, when there's sufficient rain and runoff, it'll fill up and then run out and drop down elevation. The intent is to maintain that existing pattern so that when that gets filled and graded, this drainage continues to flow down in that same direction to that large 19-acre area.
So it'll go into the area that is the
correct
easement area. Thank you.
Mr. Moore, what do you think your the developer's intent would be as far as providing some buffer between the pedestrian access and the driveway that goes into Lot 4? Is there some way that he would mark that out so that it would be clear in everybody's minds?
Right now, that particular portion of the site, which is the portion right in here, is wooded. There are a mixture of maple and oak in and around that area. If you walk that line out, there's a series of monuments, and a monument post here, and then another monument, notably a half-inch iron rebar, steel rebar, proposed to be placed along that line. And I think, I haven't spoken in any detail about that, but I'm not sure that buffering or screening along that edge is really necessary because of the fact that that's a...
There's a natural tree line that goes pretty much along that.
It's heavily wooded right now. There's not an actual tree line in the sense of a distinct field tree line in there. Rather, there are scattered trees in there.
What is the board's feeling about asking for anything further on that? Is that acceptable? It seems like a fairly natural
perhaps a good way to maintain it. And, I think perhaps we should refer to Mr. Curtis's letter, since he was not able to be here, that I do know, and I think you perhaps covered this in your presentation, that he was very interested in making sure that there were adequate buffers between the lots, particularly one and two. And you can assure us that that will be done.
The plan itself, as far as preservation of tree line, the intent between lot one and two was to maintain that existing tree line so that this does not get opened up. As a footnote to the presentation, Mr. Curtis's house, I believe, is this one here. At least that's what I'm led to believe from the name, as well as the individual walked out and spoke with me in the field one day. So the intent is to preserve this and not allow a house to actually sit down in there, which is a pretty important view shed from these homes which sit up higher than that bank.
Any other questions? I think we're all delighted that Mr. Eubank is going to affect an easement to the town eventually. What I think is some concern to the board is that a part of our submission requirements, as listed on page 30, is that we have written evidence of all easements in public open space shown on the plan to be dedicated to the town, the Developments Association, or any other third party, and copies of agreements or other documents showing the manner in which these spaces are to be maintained. Then also there is a requirement that written evidence that the town manager and town attorney are satisfied with the legal sufficiency of the documents referred to in paragraph A above, when review is deemed necessary by the board. Such written evidence shall not constitute an acceptance by the municipality of any public open space referred to in this appendix. I don't know what the rest of the board's feeling is. I think perhaps I feel uneasy not having at least know that the concept will probably gain approval, but we need some written documentation of that, and I just would like some discussion on that from other board members. Ms. Moore?
If I might address that, we did submit to the town a proposed deed and deed description of the parcel that is proposed to be conveyed to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. I believe that was reviewed by the town attorney for adequacy with regard to its form or format. That was submitted, and Nat Clifford is here and could address the issue of that actual overlay easement. Can you discuss that all, Nat?
My name is Nat Clifford. I'm president of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. As a matter of clarification, there are two documents actually in question. One is the deed transferring ownership of the land to the land trust. The second, really, the developer has no role in, and that is a conveyance of an easement from the land trust to the town. And we've discussed this with the town manager, and this is to take effect as soon as the land trust has received the deed from the developer. But it seems that both in actuality and I think in time, the two are somewhat separated, since there are different parties involved. And it might be possible, I would think, for the board to approve the project conditional on acceptance of the easement by the town, which again is a matter between the land trust and the town and does not involve the developer.
Any questions for Mr. Clifford?
If I may just respond, one of the submission requirements that's in the ordinance is that all such transfers be laid out in writing, and that both the town manager and the town attorney review them. The town attorney, about a month or so ago, did review the deed and the conditions and suggested that some additional language be put in there restricting the future use of the 19 acres for conservation purposes only, and that no construction be allowed, and that also that the town have some you know, have some noted interests that would be indicated right in the deed. It was the intent, and I think the intent of the ordinance, to make sure that all that language was submitted to the town, to this board, for your review and for the review of the town manager and the town attorney. That hasn't happened for whatever reasons. And so I think at this end, I would feel a little uncomfortable recommending that you grant conditional approval. Seems to make sense that both the town manager and the town attorney need to look at any restrictions that would apply to the deed, even though it may be once removed, with respect to the conservation easement that would run from the land trust to the town. I think it's still, you need to follow that train all the way back to the original contribution that goes from Mr. Dryden to the land trust.
Can I make a comment? It's my understanding that the deed, for obvious reasons of benefit to the developer, cannot be restricted. And I had never heard any contemplation of deed restrictions. The deed was to come to the land trust free and clear and totally unencumbered, and the encumbrances would occur in the easement which the land trust in turn would grant to the town.
We do have a letter from the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust written by Mr. Clifford, and maybe it's well to just read that, which is dated March 7th, following the transfer by deed of the Eastway 19 acres of Runaway Farm depicted as lot number 5 to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. It is the intention of the trust to offer conservation easement to the town of Cape Elizabeth on the entire 19 acres, providing for public access for passive recreation, disallowing motorized vehicles, and prohibiting development, which is certainly a good letter of intent of what will be done with the intended easement. I think what we have to decide is whether, this planning board has to decide whether we can go ahead on good faith and conditionally approve this without seeing everything written down and approved by the town lawyer and the town manager. And perhaps, Mr. Boxer, do you have any thoughts on this being legal?
I don't have a real problem with a conditional approval. I don't think it's a good habit to get into. I think we ought to be seeing the kind of terms and conditions that we're going to be approving as a general matter. There's nothing wrong with conditional approval if people want to do that. I guess that's really the issue today. Is there a timing problem from the developer standpoint? Because nothing's going to get done any faster. You still aren't going to, the approval is going to be conditioned on your approval is going to be conditioned on review by the town attorney and the town manager.
It allows us to, I think, move forward with those approvals and allows that lot then to be set up and conveyed, as Nat has said, cleanly to the land trust, because we have that board approval pending, obviously, the conditions, meeting those conditions, and release of the plat. So it establishes, if you will, the groundwork for us to proceed to the trust and have that actual easement language drawn up. And it does allow us then to move to council. But from a purely timing standpoint, I can't really address that, other than to know that Mr. Eubank indicated to me that he was hoping to break ground in March. That's what he indicated to me.
I agree with Mr. Boxer, and I'd like to see us move forward. This is a minor subdivision, and I also don't want people who might donate to the land trust to be discouraged by what seems to be a lot of bureaucracy. So I would definitely be in favor of a conditional approval.
Madam Chair,
yes, Mr.
Tinsman,
a non-voting
on this matter. And not to speak perhaps to this matter, but generically about donations of land, whether they be to abutters or any other party, third party of interest to a piece of property. I would not like to see, as a member of the planning board, a person held hostage by, let's take another example, if they wanted to donate the land to abutters, by having the board have to see the form of that in its approval process, particularly if there are conditions that can be attached to the approval. And where there's land to be donated to the town, you do have to see the form and substance of those easements, and they do have to be approved. In this case, there is a third party of interest that is going to take and handle that in the public interest. And I think it would be unfair, almost on a generic basis, across the board in development proposals, to force that to occur prior to approval.
Any other comments or thoughts?
But we do want to specify in the conditional approval what we want our council to look for. And if that's done, then I don't have a problem. We don't want to just leave it up to their discretion.
Mr. Butler?
If I may. The suggested motion before you takes that into account in terms of condition A. What you would be doing, though, is you'd be putting a condition on the applicant to do certain things before he could even go to the town council, and that the deed and the easement would both have to be reviewed by the town attorney and town manager before anything further could occur, meaning submission to the town council. The whole intent is to make sure in cases like this, and maybe in this instance, I think definitely the good faith is there, but the intent of this whole provision is not bureaucracy, I hope. It's more to ensure that something happens smoothly as it goes from where the planning board has it to the final transfer of the land. And that with negotiations, there's always a chance that, especially when you have two or more steps, that at some point an agreement can break down, in which case the board may be left in the situation with approving something with a certain understanding, and that understanding not finally resulting in everybody having egg on their face. In this case, I'm not sure that's going to be a big issue, but that's the reason why I think the town staff are pushing some caution.
Thank you, Mr. Butler. I think the board has expressed its feeling on this, and I guess I would just like to add to this that I'm very sympathetic to the gain of land for conservation purposes, which certainly this would be achieving. I think if we do have a conditional approval, we have a safety measure in that condition, in that it does not gain approval if all these conditions are not met. So I think we do have that safety gap. Perhaps before we consider the motion that's in front of you, we should consider another to discuss the public access waiver, because that would have to be granted before any approval was gained. Mr. Butler, I know you're very forward-looking. Do you have a motion up your sleeve?
I do. An added one, which the rest of the board doesn't have before them. The motion on the public access waiver would read as follows. Be it ordered that the request of Lawrence Eubanks for a public access waiver for lot number 4 of Runaway Farms, 4-lot subdivision located off Bowery Beach Road and Spurwick Avenue, be granted according to section 19.4.2b of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following condition and waiver. That would be A, that the traveled way be a minimum of 12 feet in width and be completely paved.
Would someone like to move that motion or amend it? Or
Could I just ask a question before I do? Would you tell me again the total acre of the parcel and the acreage that's going to be conveyed in each of the lots?
The total acreage of the entire subdivision, all 5 lots?
Plus the land to be donated.
28.08 acres. I believe. I'd have to flip the plan over, but it's just a tad over 28 acres.
Okay, so just subtract 19 from that, and the rest is divided up among the four lots.
The actual four lots occupy 8.83 acres.
Yeah, I wanted to be refreshed of that figure because I would move the public access waiver with the statement that I think we're being asked to vote on, it seems like, more and more public access waivers as people are looking for ways to get at land that otherwise might not be developable or might be too costly to develop. And on the basis of the kind of proposal that we're seeing before us with such a large percentage being devoted to public use and establishing the kind of precedent that it establishes, then, I believe that that public interest waiver request meets the goals of the town and the requirements of the ordinance, and so I would move the motion as Steve read it.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, as read by Mr. Butler, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It is unanimous.
With one abstaining.
With one abstaining, Mr. Pinsley.
Madam Chairman, is this still a public
We did have a public hearing and then we closed it, but if you have something...
I'm disappointed because my flyer said 7:30 in the evening. And I did want to address a few points before you pass judgment on the...
I regret very much that that occurred, and I'm sorry, we have taken a vote, but we'd be very glad to hear your comments. If you would come up and say your name and address and speak clearly. And I will reopen the public hearing.
I have three comments or so. And my name is Edmund Capano. I live on Spurwink Avenue. I abut the property. My next door neighbor is James Brunel. He abuts the property. He and I were discussing a few points of interest in regards to the development. We really do not have any objection to the development at all. And I'm very pleased, as you people are pleased, that they are willing to donate X number of acres to the land trust. I am, and Mr. Brunel is concerned that the entrance to Lot 4 on Spurwink Avenue, that no trees will be disturbed going into that lot. There are a number of trees there, they're oak and maple, but they're very thin, they're not thick in nature. When Mr. Layton owned the property, he cut out a number of trees to make the right-of-way that that is possessed now by the developer. So we are concerned about the trees as serving as a buffer. From my house, I can look right up through and see my next-door neighbor, the Logans, who's the third house up, or the second house up from me. The next point I'd like to bring up is the driveway now is dirt. Has any consideration been given to just plain gravel? You can see now I do not like blacktops. I have one in my yard and I hate it, but I have to have it. But I wondered if a drive could be made in such a fashion with gravel or sand that it would not be a hindrance to the people driving in to that lot. And
are you talking about the driveway to Lot 4?
Well, going off from Spurwink Avenue in. If that's going to be paved, I'm not going to be happy about it. I'll live with it, but I won't be happy about it.
Is that from an aesthetic standpoint?
That's from an aesthetic standpoint, and also the natural habitat as it is, you know, and I'm used to, does make a difference to me. The aesthetics, black pavement does not lend to beauty as far as I'm concerned in that area. But I can understand. Pardon?
Where is your house in relation to
that? I live in the red house by the pond. It's the drive to the entrance to lot 4, let's say, is here. Brunel lives right here. I live right there. So I'll probably 100, 200 feet or so from, maybe 3 at the most, from that line. But it's just the idea that if you pave that, I'm afraid it's going to stick out. But I can understand it. And if it comes to it, why then, of course, that's it. I'm not going to contend any point of it along the line, because I can understand people I don't like to drive through mud, so I don't suppose anybody else does, you see. But I didn't know if a construction of gravel and something could be made, and that retains the rural character of the area. Then the third one and the last one I want to just briefly touch upon is, I have to give you just a little bit of history, and would you bear with me, Madam Chairman, person. When I first moved out to Spurwink Avenue, I was on a well. And about a year and a half after I lived in the house, we sent in a sample to the state, and it came back with a recommendation that perhaps, if it's possible, not to drink the water anymore, but if you do, Clorox the system every now and then to eliminate the coliform and other bacterial count that was in it. It was exceedingly high as to the state's thinking. Now, there is a little stream that goes through my backyard into the pond, and all the rest of lot 5 is pretty solid ledge. Now, I'm concerned about how the septic system is going to be oriented on that property, and then eliminate as much of the drainage down toward the Brunels and the Capanos. I realize also that the systems from Fowler Road leach down that way. So, I mean, it's not going to be anything that's going to be new to any of us that live there. And fortunately for us, the town, in the wisdom way back when, put a whole new line in that was needed, and we are now on Sebago Water. We've been on it for years, so I don't have any problem there. But it is still a problem as far as the leachate coming down through that general area. And with all that ledge, I have a funny feeling it's going to just compound that a little bit more. And if it's possible, I think they can probably relieve our minds about that in the way they construct the septic systems and how everything will be channeled. And I appreciate y'all letting me come up here.
Fine. Maybe Mr. Moore would like to comment on the points which Mr. Capano addressed.
Certainly. Point of clarification for the board, just so that you can orient yourself to what Mr. Capano was talking about. This lot right in here, which is immediately east of the entranceway in, is the Brunel lot, which he talked about. And this right here is the, I believe, the residence of Mr. Capano, which is this lot, possibly right here, fronting out on Spurwink Avenue. And to address the couple of issues, I'd like to go to the 40-scale plan. Those of you who have been out to the site know that there's an existing driveway. It's a gravel driveway into that back portion of the parcel, and is what will become in the future, hopefully, lot 4. And if you've looked at the plan and looked at how that driveway alignment runs, that driveway alignment is kind of odd, I guess, if you look at it on the plan, because it has some funny wiggles in it in plan view. What we've done with that driveway is we have sited that down, that existing gravel lane, for the specific reasons that Mr. Eubank wanted for preservation, but also for maintenance of buffer, which he has pointed out. So the intent on this is to not do any tree removal in and around that alignment. That's part of the reason for keeping it narrow. We do recognize that as a part of this construction that goes on right where this driveway will meet spurway, we're doing a widened or creating and constructing a widened radii at that point and a culvert. So there will be some very limited tree removal of some young growth that's about 1.5 inches or 2 inches in caliper, just in this immediate area right here. But the balance of this is intended to remain as it exists with those tree buffers in there, and that's why that's shaded green. So we will be following that existing dirt alignment, or the existing dirt road alignment. I think on the second concern with regard to the blacktop driveway, there are some overriding concerns that we had as the project designers and that the applicant had for being able to preserve and maintain a driveway and not have that constantly eroding out, and in addition providing a safe and plowable access way year-round. And that's the reasoning behind the bituminous surfacing, to get a stable and efficient surface that allows that to be cleared year-round and not erode or break up, as some gravel surfaces are prone to do. On the last item, with regard to the subsurface disposal and design, all of the systems for the project are located up in the field, which our test pits indicated, which the on-site investigations indicate, are all outwash sands. Once you dig down 18 to 20 feet in these areas, you do start to pick up the ledge outcrops. And the septic systems for all of the parcels are located up in the outwash sands. And the system for lot 4, which would be the system closest to this down gradient side, is actually pulled up and into that field. So it sits not immediately over edge, but in the large deposits of outwash sand. Secondarily, we have gone to two separated systems, a gray water, black water. Specifically, we have all our gray water entering into one chamber system, and then the black water entering into a separate chamber system, and a septic tank online along with that lift station. So we feel we won't be creating any problem downstream, and we have run that through Ernie McBain for his review, and we feel comfortable that we're not creating unsanitary condition out there.
And Ernie McBain is our code enforcement officer, so that has been passed by him. We apologize once again that perhaps people did not receive notice or proper notice of the starting time for the public hearing. Is there anybody else that wants to make a comment? Yes.
My name is Ronnie Duty. I've been a fisherman all my life. I've been around here all the time, you know. So, I want to know where Mr. Eubank and Mr. Drynan are.
Mr. Drynan's over here.
Kind of worried. I was just wondering, it's such an important meeting. I was glad that someone showed up here.
Mr. Eubank's in the hospital with his father tonight.
All right, I wonder who owns the land, you or Mr. Eubank?
Excuse me, if you would direct your questions through the chair rather than having a discussion back and forth, that would be very helpful.
I'd like to know who owns the land.
Mr. Moore, do you want to answer that?
Yes, I can. The current record owner of that parcel is Edward and Janice Drynan. And as I had mentioned at the outset of the meeting, Mr. Eubank's father underwent triple or quadruple heart bypass surgery in Florida. And Lawrence tried to fly back this evening for the meeting, and he got hung up in inclement weather in Washington, D.C. So Mr. Eubank tried to be here, but was unable due to the weather.
Thank you. I think you perhaps weren't here when that explanation was given.
Once again, I point out this lot number 4. The sewage system's over here somewhere, is that right? On lot number 4? Where's the sewage system going to be?
The subsurface disposal system for Lot 4 is located at the extreme, what I would call southwesterly corner of the parcel, which occurs in that flat area at the edge of the field and the outwash sands, as I just talked about.
So you pump this from here over to here? What are you saying to me? There's Lot number 4 right here, right?
On Lot 4, there will be a subsurface tank with a lift station that will then have a force main underground pumping up into the system in the field.
That's not a long way, is it?
Excuse me, could you use the microphone for the benefit of all of us?
I'm just concerned where the sewer system is going. It's going a long ways, okay? From Lot 4 over to here. That kind of concerned because this is kind of a low area. And this is all full of water in the spring at certain times of the year. And do want to know what you're going to do with the ponds here. There's two ponds here, right here and right here. I want to know what you're going to do with them. Did I hear someone say you're going to fill these in? Is that correct?
I think as a point of order,
yes.
Chair, if he has a series of questions, can I hear the entire list of questions and then respond? I would ask for the board's direction on that.
Do you want to just ask your questions and then we'll...
Let me do the ponds.
Do you have any other questions that you wanted to ask?
Yes. I want to know what he's going to do with the ponds and is there any danger in pumping this from here to here?
And are those the extent of your questions?
And I'm a little concerned about development here. I don't... I talked to Mr. Dryden and bought some land over in Scarborough, and I call this milk on the land. I don't think these people are giving any consideration towards the deer or whatever, and I think this land here they're giving to the trust fund, I don't think if it was, trust you, Mr. Clifford, I don't think they'd give it to him if it was good land. I think they'd put houses on it, that's all I can say. And I just hate, I talked to Mr. Curtis, and he hates to see this land go, and we all hate to see it go, you know, a lot of people do.
I think we all hate to see the land vanish, but I think most of the board feels very happy about the amount of land that is going to be saved for open space, and this, we hope that it will protect the area where you're living at, or in perpetuity, so.
And another thing I'm concerned about is these are all expensive houses, and every inch of land in Cape Elizabeth is going to be all expensive houses, because there's so much money in it, and it's... doesn't leave nothing for our children later on, you know, so.
That is a concern of the townspeople as well, and the comprehensive plan, if you've been following that group, has been studying that issue.
I think you should stop development because you can't be fair to the affordable housing. So I don't think there's no room for affordable housing in Cape Elizabeth. So I think you should try to stop these developers as much as you can. And you're doing a very good job, but I think you should maybe... These people come in, they're hard on the roads, the kids come in, and we got to pay for the taxes. The taxes don't meet, the taxes are very high, but Mr. Daigle over here has been very fair with the taxes, but we get stuck paying from the developer. He puts all kinds of money in his pocket. He rides off in the sunset with a couple Cadillacs or what have you. We get stuck paying the bills.
Thank you very much. And are those the extent of your questions?
That's it. Thank you, people.
Mr. Moore, do you want to address the ponds?
To the extent that I can, yes. The initial question on the pump design, force main and pumping station, and how that might present a potential hazard. No, it is not too far to pump. That total pumping distance is approximately 415 feet. And we're dealing with about 7 feet of head or 7 feet of grade elevation. We have sized the pumps and the tank accordingly, and the way the system is set up with that 400-foot run being a continuous line of 220 PSI piping, I don't think you're going to have a problem with leakage or breakage in that line across that dip. With regard to the existing land and the overdevelopment, I think at one of the initial presentations, we talked about the alternatives that we explored in our office with regard to development of this particular parcel. We had looked at the existing soils, the outwash sands that I've talked about a couple times, and looked at other ways that the site could be developed with respect to creating a new road in or through the site. We looked at the site for a multiplex development project, notwithstanding its zone. And when you look at the site and look at it in terms of developing lots and being able to put subsurface disposal systems in and meet the code of the town, in other words, strict adherence with the new subdivision ordinance, you're looking at a total site development capability, if you will, of somewhere between 5.5 to 6.5 units. And when we looked at this for Mr. Eubank and looked at its development potential, we set that aside and looked at it as what would be the best for the particular site, for its inherent carrying capability, and to meet the spirit of the new ordinance. And in looking at that, we scaled those plans back considerably when you look at a 6-to-4 movement in terms of lot reduction. So although I realize that's a sort of an ideal and a mythical number, I point that out simply for the board's edification and to refresh your memory that that was discussed early on as part of the overall planning for the site. Obviously, there is some wildlife out there. We've looked at that. We know that we have a large wet area down in the rear that has a very rich flora and fauna, and that's why we decided to set that land aside. That was part of that whole scenario where that would become something that could maintain an area of wildlife in this section of the town, and therefore we feel that although we have houses, we are having some development, we're not placing those in a way where they substantially affect either existing habitat or major wildlife corridors. And I think on the last item with respect to the ponds, there are two areas that I had mentioned earlier in the drainage discussion that are expended areas where the gravel's been mined and they now collect water. One is this area here, which we'll talk about in some detail, and the other down in here. The intent is to leave this in its present form because it does perform some stormwater detention functions. It does fill up, flow out, and run down in. And because of its proximity to the start of the larger area, we did feel it has some value with respect to its wetlands functions and pond functions. So that area down there is being left intact. This area, as we've discussed, is being graded out, filled, and regraded to get positive drainage out of that area for the reasons I discussed earlier.
Thank you. Are there any other people who are interested in making a comment of new information on this development? If not, I will close the public hearing. And we did have a motion. I hope that we've addressed your answers and given you some answers to some of your questions. And I just would personally again like to say that I think this is an excellent development, the kind of development that we would like to see in Cape Elizabeth and need to encourage. So you have your conditional approval, and
did we take a vote?
I'm sorry, we do not have it. I'm premature. We have a motion in front of us. We have an addition to that, and perhaps Mr. Butler could read the motion so that you can call to hear the full wording.
What I've done before I read it is to delete C, which has already been addressed, that issue in terms of the visual buffer between the driveway and the easement. And I've added something in between A and C, which talks about the review by the town manager and the town attorney, which really should be in there to make sure you're not waiving a submission requirement. So with all that said, I'll read the amended suggested motion. Be it ordered that the request of Lawrence Eubanks for final plan approval for Runway Farms, a four-lot subdivision located off Bowery Beach Road, be granted according to section 16-2-3 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that the deed for the land to be conveyed to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust explicitly states that the land will be used for conservation purposes, that construction will be prohibited, and that it specifies that the town has an interest in enforcing the two above mentioned restrictions. B, that the deed and the easement from the land trust to the town be reviewed and approved by the town manager and the town attorney. And C, that the entrance to the pedestrian easement off Spruing Avenue be clearly and appropriately marked as such an entrance.
You heard the motion. Would someone like to move it?
Madam Chairman.
Excuse me, just before we do. Yes, Mr. Moore?
If I could ask for a couple of points of clarification, please. Steve, your motion indicated it was a four lot. I believe it's a five lot subdivision.
I'm sorry.
Did
you're
I
right.
mishear that?
Yeah. It should be five lot. And I'll let you say and see if I got it.
The second request that we have is one that Nat spoke to a little earlier, in that our best thinking at this point in the way this is proposed to be conveyed is that the deed itself be a clean deed passing the land through to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, but that a separate easement document be drawn up that will be an overlay easement on that entire parcel. That would contain the language that would be reflected or reflective of what is indicated in Mr. Clifford's letter, that it be a parcel dedicated solely to or for conservation purposes, that there be no mechanized vehicles, that it be for passive recreational use.
So that we could revise that motion, perhaps just to say that the easement be approved by both the easement conveyed from the land trust to the town, be approved by the town attorney and the town manager.
And rather than the deed, it's the deed explicitly state, rather than the overlay easement explicitly state.
And perhaps adding the language and following the language that's in Nat Clifford's
yes.
letter of March 7th, 1988.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is everyone clear on what how the motion would read? And could we have someone move that?
Before we move, I guess maybe it's appropriate after it's been seconded for discussion. I have a question about why subparagraph C was deleted. Subparagraph C refers to the buffer between the driveway and the easement to Spurwink Avenue.
Right. The original reason why I was in there was the thought was that perhaps some additional sort of buffering should be required. My thought was that if the applicant was proposing to leave the existing amount of trees that would border driveway, that perhaps talking about a visual buffer wouldn't necessarily be needed.
That would be redundant.
Approval of the plan then suggests that
yes,
buffer will stay.
That's where, and the facts presented kind of
okay.
comes in.
All right.
Hopefully that'll be on the record.
Okay. I'll move passage of the
Mr. Russ has
order.
Moved, and is there a second?
One second.
Is there any discussion on the motion? If not, all those in favor, raise your right hand. Mrs. Guthrie, are you with us?
Oh, sorry. Thank you.
You're
reminding me of
reading
something.
the motion is carried by four, voting and one abstaining, Mr. Vincent. And you do have your conditional approval.
Thank you very much, board members. We appreciate your time and effort.
Thank you. Our next item of business has been struck from the agenda, and I would like a motion from the board that we set a public hearing for May on the zoning ordinance section 19-4-7.
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Tim.
What is that about?
This is
an
ordinance which really is state mandated, and what it does is to limit the length of time of a variance to a year. In other words, it sunsets a variance to a year's time.
You said it struck from the agenda, or do you just want to assess the public hearing?
There was not notice sent out for, that was a public hearing. Since we are supposed to have a public hearing.
So it's not struck from the agenda, but tonight we can take it up and set for public hearing.
Yes.
Okay, I would move that we set for public hearing at our next regular meeting at 7:05.
Good. And is there a second?
Second.
There has been moved and seconded that we set for public hearing the zoning ordinance addition under section 19-4-7 for 7:05 at the next meeting. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And opposed? The motion is unanimous.
Madam Chairman, a quick point of order. We need to sign the Runaway Farms plan, and then Jerry will hold it until the conditions are met. So if everybody would like to take out their infamous black pens, take a moment to do that. Yep, that'll do it.
Why is
Standing here,
right? And the date is the 19th?
Yes.
Could I have put the time? Eastfield Road coming in for a zone change from RP to RA under section 19-4-9B. And I would just remind the viewing audience as well as this live audience that we have had a public hearing and we have had extensive presentations. I would like to ask if Mr. Plummer would like to make some brief comments or a brief presentation without anything further.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I would like to make a few comments. I have six items I'd like to cover, all of them non-legal.
You were here for the early show.
I was. Number one, we have provided the Planning Board with information required under the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance for proposals for change of zone. Number two, the issue before the board is not whether these lots are wetlands. The issue is whether the lots are properly designated as a resource protection zone. The difference we think is crucial. Even when land is designated as wetlands, home construction is allowed, and there is at least the possibility of obtaining a wetlands alterations permit desired. lots in Resource Protection District cannot be built on. There is an absolute prohibition. Number three, the Eastfield lots were rezoned to the RP District under Section 19.2.8, subsection 4 of the zoning ordinance. Subsection 4 does not state the basis for zoning land to the Resource Protection District other than stating the district shall include, and I quote, all other land so designated on the official zoning map, unquote. Number four, the approved Eastfield lots were rezoned to the RP district on the assumption that the soils and the lots consisted of Sebago Mucky Peat. The basis of that assumption was the Cumberland County Soil Survey, which indicated that the Eastfield lots consisted of Sebago Mucky Peat. Number five, the soil survey is an error. We have provided the board reports and testimony from the engineering firm of Sebago Technics that show that none of the soils on the lots consist of Sebago Mucky Peat. And furthermore, that the soils that are there are buildable. For this reason, number six, for this reason, the lots should have never been zoned within the RP district in the first place. That's the end of my statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cummins. I would just also like to explain the procedure for the benefit of the public. We, the Planning Board, has the responsibility tonight to vote on a recommendation to the Town Council. We have held a public hearing and there has been input from both the applicant and from the public. After we make a recommendation tonight, the procedure is that the recommendation will travel to the Town Council, where once again there will be a public hearing conducted so that both the applicant and the public has another opportunity to comment. I would also just ask if there is briefly anyone from the general public that has a brief comment. This is not a public hearing, so if you have any new information, we could hear that, but it would have to be very brief. If not,
Madam Chairman.
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes.
Madam Chairman, we wanted to know whether or not the Planning Board received a memo that was sent to the Planning Board concerning the EPA visiting the site and concerning from Mike Cooper, because we didn't hear that in the beginning part, whether that was received.
Yes, both of those letters were included in the Board's package, as well as a letter from Mr. Beebe, dated April 15th.
Oh, okay.
That was all.
Quinn, just as a matter of...
Excuse me, could you just
identify
yourself
before you go? My name is Joan French, and I live on Eastfield Road. I guess just as a matter of rebuttal, although we did hear before about Sebago Mucky Peat and the soils at the public hearing, that in our ordinances, it says that they have to demonstrate by way of an on-site survey that the land does not constitute either wetlands as defined above or Sebago Mucky Peat. So that our contention of saying that these are wetlands that do have to be dealt with still remain under the resource protection zone. And that it be understood. The other thing I found really interesting, we were able to get a hold of the minutes of the Comprehensive Planning Committee back in 1978. And one thing that they stated, that they recommended, they were concerned about establishing the RP zones, and they said that they wanted the board to consider and adopt controls and tools for dealing with surface water runoff in all areas of the Cape, where runoff is not a threat to Great Pond. In other words, they were just concerned about surface water runoff. And in taking this position, we are aware that if such controls are not adopted, the town will inevitably face a major, costly public works program to remove such runoff by means of stormwater drains, culverts, and perhaps some form of treatment. So I think that that was part of their concern in our area. It was definitely a wetlands, and they were concerned about the town being stuck with the drainage. And so far, in any of these plans that we've seen, there are no drainage plans in this area for the housing. And that's of tremendous concern to us as residents, that that's not even an acknowledgement of it. And we already have been stuck as residents in Cape Elizabeth for this development. Back in 1968, there is an easement, and it's in the Registry of Deeds, where the inhabitants of Cape Elizabeth bought the easement and created a culvert and are to maintain it to drain the surface water off of Eastfield Road when they first put the other houses in. So our concern is we just don't want to get stuck again. Thank you.
I would just remind the board that you also received in your packet a letter from Mr. Westerfeld, and I would just like to comment or address a few of his points, one of which was that he understood the board would be hiring a wetlands specialist to look at the resource protection zone in the Eastfield Road area. The board discussed and was polled on this, and they came to the conclusion that really we had enough testimony from the public and from Sebago Technics supplied to us by FS Plumber. We've had an excellent site walk, and we felt very strongly that we really could make a judgment on this without doing that. One other point which I'd like to bring up briefly is it was suggested that perhaps a member of our board, Mr. Kinsman, represented a conflict of interest, and I would like to ask him just to address that.
I'm not sure that I haven't talked to Tom Leahy about whether it's a conflict of interest, but I understand, Madam Chairman, that you have. Years ago in the initial development, one of my relatives did that development, but no longer holds any interest, I understand. That was one of my first questions when this development came in, whether there was any interest owned by any relatives of mine in the property. I understand that that is not the case, that there is no further interest in that, that Mr. Plummer owns entirely the land by himself. In order for a conflict of interest to exist, there has to be an appearance of or pecuniary interest in some part of the project where I might benefit financially from the project. That is simply not the case. I don't feel that there's a conflict of interest. I think on this board, if there's anyone that feels a conflict of interest more than anyone else, I have some of those just by having lived here all my life and having had relatives who have developed pieces of the town. To answer your direct question and to the letter to the board, I do not feel that there's a conflict of interest. I understand Mr. Leahy also feels that there is no conflict of interest, and I do intend to vote on this matter.
Good. As you understand from, perhaps you don't, the planning board rules and procedures state that it is up to the person on the planning board to disclose whether he has any conflict or interest in the board discussion. The chairman makes a ruling as to whether there is one, and the chair would rule that there is no conflict of interest in this case. I have talked with Tom Leahy, our legal counsel, and he has advised us that also.
I just wanted to straighten or clear up some of those matters first before we go on. And I think it is up to the board to now consider, from all the information that they have received, from their site visits, from the material that was submitted by F.S. Plummer, what your pleasure would be about dealing with these lots and whether you wish to change any of the lots from an RP to an RA, or whether and whether there are any lots that you wish to keep retained in RP, and for what reasons. I personally felt, after having viewed the videotapes presented by the neighbors' public hearing, and by actually tromping over the site, by visiting with a representative from an environmental firm called IEP, who took some borings in the area, that lots 27, 31, and 32 should remain in the resource protection area. I did feel that lots 44 and 30 could be removed, and that most of the vegetation on 30, on both 30 and 44 were of an upland type. Even though perhaps 30 has been a lot of landfill. I'd like to hear some discussion from other board members before we consider a vote or comments.
Mrs. Guthrie. Mrs. Rand, I agree with you about the vegetation on lots 27, 31, and 32, but I am very concerned about the filling of primarily lot 30. Lot 44 was filled, according to Sebago Technics, in 1964. Lot 44 has just a very tiny portion as resource, designated as resource protection zone. It lies in a corner, a very small corner of the lot. It is really sort of hair-splitting to even consider that little tidbit, because you have setbacks to contend with when you are building houses. There is a house there already. So I really don't even want to discuss lot 44. Nothing could be put there anyway. But on lot 30...
Lot 44, excuse me, already has a house on it.
Yes, it does. And if the portion of that property that was designated as resource protection is so small, nothing could ever be put there anyway because of setbacks. I mean, even a doghouse wouldn't be put there because it's too close to the road and the dog would be disturbed. Now let's go to lot 30, which is primarily fill. The fill, I think, is what concerns me. A curious person has to say, who filled it? Who was the authority behind that? When was it filled? How much was filled? Were permits granted? We are not a detective agency. And if we did find the answers to those questions, then we would have to make perhaps some legal judgments that our attorney has advised us not to make. So on lot 30, I see absolutely no proof. I see absolutely no proof on any of the lots that any of the resource protection designation should be removed. As far as I can see, it was valid.
Other comments or questions? Yes, well, Mr. Russ.
Can I ask a question? I'm sorry.
No,
I didn't.
Seniority takes... Mr.
Watson.
You are, yeah, you're right.
Is there some evidence that that was at one time a lot which has subsequently been filled? I know that we were we're talking about has been filled and contains little or no wetland vegetation. What's missing in the proposed findings of fact is some indication as to whether that was a wetland. There are lots of places that are filled that aren't wetlands. Does the available evidence indicate that that was a wetland, if it was filled?
I'm probably not the best person to answer it. At this point, it's really unclear what the previous condition was. I've heard information from both sides. I think the board out there recognized the fact that whatever it was, it is now filled.
So we have no proof.
Mr. Daigle might be able to shed a little more light.
But there is, Maren, you're basing your statement on something that you heard and something that you saw and some evidence that it was a wetland?
No. I'm saying that we can't determine anything about this lot now because the proof, whatever it was, if there was proof, is gone. And also, the recent filling, which according to Sebago Technics, took place in the recently, in the last 2 years, is something that could become a legal issue that this board, it is not within our purview to make those judgments.
But if it doesn't presently fit a definition that is covered by our resource protection district, and we don't have any evidence that it did, then it seems to me we still have to have a basis. And I'm not comfortable saying that if somebody went and filled a wetland that was qualifying as a resource protection district, that they therefore beat the system. But I think there has to be some indication, and I think there'd be some support for that. I think there are lots of situations where wetlands that have been filled, even though now they don't meet the definition, you have the hook to hang your hat on. But it seems to me we have to have some indication that that happened here. Otherwise, we have a piece of land that doesn't meet the definition that is required to be a resource protection district, and we have no basis for saying, let's keep it in that district. I'm not sure whether I confused you or not.
No, I can see your point. Mr. Rice.
I think a decision which this board needs to make is whether or not the designation in the first instance was correct, whether there was adequate criteria on which to make that decision. And I'm, during the last meeting, was nearly convinced by the information that had been submitted to us, which is more history than on the land that we're considering than any other parcel I've had a chance to review since I've been on the board. But the information that was presented dates back as far as 1961, I believe, and there is consistent evidence from that time forward that the town reviewed this land and designated it resource protection with adequate criteria. I had to still be convinced, however, by a site walk that designation made sense to me, and was convinced at the site walk that, in fact, was an appropriate designation. I don't know what is under that fill either, but I know what is all around it, and it would be very unusual, I think, to have in that low-lying area land that is not a wetland when everything all the way around that particular piece was wetland. And I'm convinced by the information that we have from previous studies and comprehensive planning and so forth that was an appropriate designation, and I haven't been presented enough information to suggest any reason for changing. So I would vote not to recommend that it be redesignated.
That none of the lots be changed?
None of them. He sort of answered my question.
Tenson, do you have some thoughts?
Madam Chairman, I agree with most of what Mr. Russ has indicated. And, One of the things that the planning board has to do in its sidewalks is to review the land and actually put your feet in the gravel or the wetland. And there have been many cases over the past several years where the planning board has gone to a piece of property to look at an RP designation and found that because of the nature of the mapping, that resource protection either was not appropriate. We have a number of pieces in town where resource protection is indicated that this board has allowed a dwelling to be placed or an outbuilding to be placed where clearly it was not resource protection for one purpose or another. In this case, I agree with Mr. Russ. In the initial designation as resource protection, it was based on a number of criteria, one of which was the wetland conditions, existing and prevalent nature. And surely lot 27, 31, and 32 are very wet soils and would appear to be appropriate if we were designating resource protection today on a piece of land, contiguous land parcels that are generally wet in nature. I'm not as convinced on lot 30 or 44 for whatever reasons, and whenever the fill occurred or however it was done, it is in fact done at this point, and it does not appear, as other properties in the past, that resource protection is an appropriate land designation for that. So as one member of the board, I would be in favor of keeping 27, 31, and 32 as resource protection clearly, and make lot 30 and 44 debatable.
Would you enjoy some more debate on lots 30 and 44? Yes, Mr. Bobson.
Steve, are you satisfied in what you have looked at and what you presented to us, that you've answered the question raised in the various letters from the applicant about the definition, specifically paragraph 4, resource protection district? Can you address that?
Sure. 2 points. I think on some of the lots in question, it's abundantly clear that according to the applicant's own information, that lots contain characteristics that meet the definition of circular 39. That's one of the designated definitions of the wetland in the town's ordinance. The other aspect with the other lots is that they have been designated Sebago Mucky Peat in quotation marks. That was done using the best available information, which is the Cumberland County Soil Survey. The board heard and has discussed the whole issue of how that designation was formed. Norm Kalick, who's a soil scientist with the U.S. Soils Conservation Service, has indicated that when that designation was identified on the Cumberland County Soil Survey, due to the scale that they had, that was a broad definition, and they had to include a lot of soils types in that, one of which was the Togus fibrous peat type of soil. So that whole issue also, I think, kind of helps get at the point in terms of, even though technically, when you get down to a site-specific analysis, that at least for two of the lots, I feel that even though they're technically togus, that meets the intent of the ordinance in terms of calling it Sebago Mucky Peat.
So you feel that anything that meets the definition of Circular 39 or is Sebago Mucky Peat becomes a resource, or is entitled to be noted on the map as resource protection district?
Right. In addition, just take a moment. Right. I guess the third point that I would just add is circular 39 also talks about land submerged water for some or part of the, for all or part of the year. Again, that's another factor that should be addressed. Yeah.
Joe, I guess your point is that since they are designated and since the site walk reveals that it's likely that they were filled at one time, that therefore they deserve
they deserved to be, still deserve to be, resource protection district.
Madam Chairman, on that one point, it's at least my view that how I've been looking at these lots is based on the current condition. So, I mean, I would, the board is will make the decision as it sees fit. I guess it's a tough line to draw in terms of what used to be there, what once was there. We've heard from the applicant that at one time this land was farmed. That argument doesn't hold much water for me because right now, at least in some of the lots, I mean, it's wet. It's a wetland. It was designated as such. It was designated resource protection. So from my perspective, I would see that, I guess I focus really on the existing conditions.
I think Steve makes a very good point in that although there has been a lot of fill and perhaps the fill was not justly put there, the conditions that presently exist might not really fit the bill of resource protection area. So that I guess I also feel fairly strongly that there's a great deal of upland vegetation on lots 30, and I think that presently that land has been altered such from what it may have been at one point that it would not be an injustice to call it an RA. But we are hoping for more discussion. Any other thoughts? Yes, Mrs. Bell.
Well, I have a question about how we've gone about this. My interpretation of an RA zone is just one entity. We have gone about this sort of considering lots of little RA zones, meaning RA zone lot 27, RA zone lot 31. We've done this on a lot-to-lot basis. And I wonder how would we engage in a study if an owner of just one parcel came forward and he had not had any designated lots and said to us, I want you to reconsider the RA zone on my land. How would we reconsider that?
If it's not zoned, he would have to apply for a zone change.
Yes, but how would we study that? If it were just in one lump. We have just now looked at all sorts of little RA zones in what should be just one contiguous large RA zone. How would we have studied this had we been approached by a landowner who did not have designated lots and who wanted the RA zone reconsidered?
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
If I might, I think that's a good question, but it's a hypothetical question.
Mm-hmm. But it could happen.
It could happen, and it probably will at mm-hmm. some point in our history as a board. Nonetheless, we have a contiguous RA zone,
mm-hmm.
and that's divided at some point on the face of the earth with an RP designation to resource protection, which was done a number of years ago by a board, presumably after some good consideration and some indication that there were some reasons for drawing a line where they were. I think that this happens to be a subdivision that was formally approved by the planning board at some time in the distant past. I think that's why we're looking at it as a bunch of little RA zones, if
mm-hmm.
you will. But it's not really a bunch of small RA zones. We're really talking about where to draw the line
mm-hmm.
for not where to draw, but where to, an applicant's request, whether or not to redesignate where that boundary exists. If it's south of or east of the that road, or all the way east of the property as requested by the applicant, or whether it's west of that road, including lots 30 and 44, is really the issue that we're facing. It just happens that 30 and 44 on the west side of the road, and 27, 30, and 32 on the east side of the road. I think, as one board member, I know what you're saying, and I think that that will happen, but it will happen in the context of where to draw a line if there's an issue of development coming up, and then we'll see the proposals for any lot designations coming out of that. That is not too much different from some of the things that happened in the recent Stonegate developments where RP districts were designated, particularly in the first phase, and we had to really take a look at what wetlands those existed where, whether or not to give wetland alterations permits for some of the road construction, and then how to hold the houses out of a certain wetland area having restrictions. We'll face again later with a similar issue where Elizabeth Farm is proposing to do away with the buildable areas designation. The subdivision plan will be dealing with that later in the agenda. But all very similar issues because they're lot specific on previously approved subdivision plans. To me, it's really a question of does it make sense for a resource protection district to exist given the conditions that exist today, yes or no? If yes, then RP should stay there. If no, then maybe it should be moved. And I think most of the board members have been here when we've gone out on sidewalks and looked at RP district where a line was drawn at some point in time on one piece of property and somebody wanted to put in a garage. Richard Road was, Fowler Road, recent example.
Route 77.
Route 77, yes. Where we went in, walked the site and said, this is clearly yes or no, a resource protecting district by the character of the land. I think in Route 77 it included recent fill that had existed by some previously approved planning and by some previously approved building permit. And I think that this is a very similar example to the Route 77. I think that's a good example of allowing a garage to go into an area that had been previously filled by some action that had allowed that to exist by the town. I guess that's where I come down, that it does not appear that those two lots west of the road are wetland vegetation, or that that they maybe even deserve the resource protection districting. And I guess even with the additional debate, that's where I'm coming down.
I think under your theory that someone could fill the resource protection district then a few years later come and ask that it be redesignated because they have changed it from the characteristics that make up the definition.
If that was done in violation of the laws of the town, which does not allow filling in the resource protection district, then I think that's an issue. And I don't know here where we've been able to determine whether that was done after a resource protection district was implemented on that site, or whether it was before, whether it's historically there, or what existed there before. I also know that when you develop properties that in place fill and roads, that you do in fact sometimes create wetlands out of areas where you have now standing water over 20 years of time, and all of a sudden you have wetland vegetation existing. We see that happening all the time. So when you change the existing character of the surface. I wouldn't want to presume that a person could fill in a wetland and then come in and ask for designation as RA district at some point in time. I would hope that would occur, and I hope that we wouldn't allow the filling of resource protection with soils in violation of town laws. I'm not sure that that's the case here. I mean, Marion mentioned that this is filled in the last 2 years.
According to Sebago Technics Incorporated.
Perhaps, but I don't know that.
I,
I think, Dick, that you draw a good analogy when you compare this site perhaps to the judgment that we made on Route 77 with we were in effect almost placed in a situation where it would have been a hardship, extreme hardship, had we not designated or allowed the garage to be built.
I don't think we designated, we allowed the construction of resource protection as an accessory use.
That's true. And as our laws stand now, of course, we can build on resource protection. So, in fact, we did bend up. Madam Chairman, I'm so sorry if I'm slowing down this process, but I do have some questions. And I'd like to just point out that Lot 27 and Lot 30 and Lot 44 have resource protection designations, but part of the other part of the lot is RA zone. Now, we have on page 19-17 of the zoning ordinance, section 19-2-10, something that I wonder if it is still on the record. Lots in two or more districts. Now, I'm not an expert on ordinances, but it says, where a district boundary line, as established in this ordinance and as shown on the zoning map, divides a lot which was of record at the time of enactment of this ordinance, the use and other requirements applying to the less restricted portion of such lot under this ordinance may be extended 30 feet beyond the district boundary line into the lot in the more restricted district. So does that apply to Mr. Plummer's lots? Does that mean since he has two lots in two different districts, they were lots of record 20 years ago, does that mean that he can take 30 feet into the RP zone, and which would give him fewer restrictions on his lots?
Well, that's a very good question, Mary. I don't know that I have the answer to that question, Mr.
So you see, I mean, to change the...
David, do you have, as a long-standing studier of the ordinances...
I would add that if the RP is in fact a district, if we can say or conclude that that is a district, and I think your interpretation is correct, whereby where two districts come into onto one house lot, then the 30 feet would protrude into the more restricted. But I guess the first question we have to answer is RP a district?
But if that is the case, then Lot 44 with the little corner is of no consequence. Lot 30, where the little semicircle of RP would allow 30 feet, you could take 30 feet of that on a small lot like that. So I see absolutely no reason to change any designation when so much is... The restrictions are not as, it's not as limiting if this indeed applies to these lots in question.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I think Mary's absolutely right. And I think that's a good point. That if someone wants to apply for a building permit and is able to do that, as Jerry Daigle indicates, or resituate the house so that it's outside the RP district, then the discussion is academic. If this board says, in fact, 27, 31, and 32 are actually should be designated as resource protection and remain that way, I would concur. And I think that 27, 31, and 32 should stay RP.
Are we coming to a point where we can entertain a motion? Discussion. it might be helpful to you, before we consider a motion, just to go down the meeting of the board to see how everybody is feeling, maybe starting with Mr. Russ.
You want me to tell you how I'm going to vote?
We don't have to say that.
It's not a secret ballot.
Just your thoughts on how you feel after, as a result of the discussion.
I guess my attitude, my opinion of the three lots that everyone seems to think ought to be kept resource protection remain the same. I guess the part of the decision regarding or what has happened to Lot 30 that concerns me the most, and this one that Dan commented on, was the fact that a zone that was created for a particular reason, and I'm satisfied that whichever board and whichever council made those decisions made the right one, that the land can be altered, and then several years hence, we are asked to make a decision to rezone that. I find that troublesome. And I know it's not Mr. Plummer's fault, that happened, that that fill is in what was a resource protection zone. I guess I'm having the hardest time making a decision to rezone something or a resource protection zone that should not have become something other than a resource protection zone inappropriately. I commented about on the, and I've just been looking at the map, the lot lines fairly carefully, especially with respect to the arch and the resource protection zone as it goes into lot 30. When I made the comment that the fill in lot 30 is surrounded by wetland, or what I consider to be wetland or resource protection, that area of the lot is in fact RA, and I wasn't aware of that. So I would say 3/4 of lot 30 and what I saw to be the wettest part of lot 30 has in fact been zoned RA by this town sometime in the past. I could support a rezoning of lot 30 to RA, I think, based on that. I wasn't sure, without first looking at this, the extent of the resource protection zone into that lot. Seeing how it abuts RA, I think I could support that, but could not on the others. See no reason to rezone that portion of lot 44. It's simply too small and, I think, insignificant.
Mr. Tinsman, have you any different thoughts or would like to add?
No difference.